Hi everybody, this is Azar, physical therapist. Today we're going to go over the normal gait pattern, which is normal walking pattern, and how to recognize normal from abnormal. And since it's more related to the ankle, we're covering it in the ankle section. But of course the knee and hip and even lower back muscle and core muscles are very important in having a normal walking pattern. So all of us are born with almost normal walking pattern, some of us a little bit different, but if it's a noticeable difference which is causing issue, then we have to recognize that and we have to recognize why that problem happening and how we can correct that. So we're gonna go ahead and watch the normal walking pattern in a minute, and I marked my right ankle for you guys to follow my right ankle, because if you cannot follow both at the same time, right and left, then it's going to get very confusing for you to follow both. Because whatever the right side does, the left side does the opposite, which it has to. So because it's like a rhythm of the gait. So this one's doing this, and then this one's in another phase, and then the right comes to the phase two, and then left comes to the phase one again. So go ahead and follow my right foot. If you're ready, we're going to start. So the normal gait starts with the initial contact, which is the first phase of stance. Stance phase is the phase that one of the foot that we're actually following, which is the right foot, on the floor. During that we have that contact to the floor, everything on that phase calling the stance phase. It could be the initial stance, mid stance, or terminal stance. When the foot's on the air, which again my right foot's on the air, of course my left foot's in the stance, then we're going to call it swing phase. It's the initial, mid swing, and then terminal swing. So whenever we hit the floor, when the foot's on the floor, stance, and when the foot's on the air, up on the air, swing phase. And then the stance phase and swing phase keep repeating, and then they're opposite in right leg and left leg. So and we're going to start with the initial contact. That's initial contact, the heel has to have the first contact to the floor. And then we have the knee fully straight, and it's going to be a couple of fraction of a second, and then we're going to change it to the initial stance. Initial stance is when the foot's getting ready to get on the floor without supporting the other leg. And then in the mid stance, the other leg gets off. That's the time that we need a good balance, not to fall, to keep that one leg on the floor. Most people have problem with this phase, especially if you people with a balance issue and weakness. And then the terminal stance is in the phase again, in the right foot. Look at my right foot. The terminal stance is when the foot's still on the floor, but is getting ready to get off the floor and enter the swing phase. So when we enter the swing phase, we have to have a rocking movement. We have to have a good ankle rocking movement. The ankle is plantar flexing and the knee is flexing to get ready for a very good smooth stance phase, which is the initial stance. Mid stance, the foot's gonna go forward, we're trying to proceed forward, and then the foot's in that position. The terminal swing is gonna be when the heel gets ready to do the initial contact again. So we're entering back to the initial contact and stance phase. Again, looking at my right foot, we're starting here, doing this. Okay, so I want you to follow it one more time, and I'm going to only name the phases this time, okay? So we're going to start with initial contact, initial stance, mid stance, terminal stance, toe off, and starting of a swing phase, fully toe off, initial swing, mid swing, terminal swing, again another initial contact, initial stance, mid stance, terminal stance, toe off, initial swing, mid swing, terminal swing, and another initial contact. So that's the phase of the gait. And if you follow the other foot now, you can see that the other foot's doing exactly opposite in the same time. Simultaneously with the other one, be doing the opposite things in the other foot. So if we don't have that rhythm, there's no way that we can hold our balance. So now let's pay attention one by one what we have in every part of the gait. So the first phase of the gait, we have to have a very good dorsiflexion. So if we don't have a dorsiflexion, we cannot have a good initial contact. So in dorsiflexion, I have my heel pushing a little bit and my knee has to be in extension. If I don't have a knee extension, it's going to be again a problem. And then what I need for that phase is I'm going to start needing the good stability of the hip muscles and knee muscles and ankle muscles for starting for balance. Some people don't have a good balance, so what happens is they go really fast and they prematurely put the other foot on the floor because they cannot tolerate having enough time on the mid stance for equilibrium and balance. So what happens is these people, they kind of go like this. When they go like this, they have to go very fast. The other one have to be on the floor very fast because they cannot tolerate too much weight bearing on this side. So if you see people walking like that, so they cannot really have enough time on the one leg, then they have a balance issue. So the next phase, we talked about this, we need a dorsiflexion and extension, and we need a good balance here. And then what we need in that one? In that one, we need a knee to be able to flex, and we can have the good ankle flexibility to roll on the toes. And then for toe off, we're going to be able to have a good knee flexion. And then when we flex the knee, we also flex the hip at the end of this phase. And then again, we have to have a good knee extension and dorsiflexion to start over. So kind of simple. If you think about it like this is the phases of gait that keeps repeating and we have to have a good balance, you're going to learn that. Just a couple of small things that you need to pay attention. While we're walking, we have to have a proper hand movement. Some of us, we don't know that the hands are moving. If the hands are not moving, for some people that have neurological issue, the hands not moving, then they're going to have balance issue actually. Our hand needs to move kind of with the walking, right? So our hands basically swinging on the air while we walk. Another thing that's happening, and we don't even notice that, the hips a little bit rotating. So for example, if I want to do the catwalk, I'm going to be like doing this, right? But I'm not going to go like that. Exaggerating, but we have to kind of do a little bit of catwalking while we're walking. So we have to have a little bit of rotation of a pelvis. If we don't, we have a very stiff pelvis and we have a very stiff spine, we're going to have problems in walking, noticeable. Because we're not going to have that little bit of a rotation every time that we are trying to take the step. Okay, so a little bit of rotation is needed while we're taking steps. Another thing that's important in walking is the timing. Sometimes we have to really make sure that we do the good timing on everything. So if we do it real fast and we don't give him enough time, then we're not going to be able to finish the phase in the other side and it's going to be premature walking. Some people with the Parkinson, some people that have very fast movement, they have that and they cannot really have all the movement happening because of being so fast and so premature. Sometimes you don't have a good dorsiflexion, so people landing instead of with the heel, with the toes. That's very, very important and very common. People land with the toes, that's a problem. So we have to land with the heel first, always, okay? We see that in the people with the stroke, they don't have enough dorsiflexion. We also see them in people that they have very limited dorsiflexion, and people that are toe walkers, like autistic people, and some other people that have been walking on the toes. So they tend to go like this, landing with the toes, which is wrong. Sometimes we just have a little bit of unevenness in the steps, so we just not having both sides at the same strength. For example, if the hips not having enough strength, the glutes doesn't have enough strength, when I'm in the stance, you know, at my other side, then this one that drop, this one can drop because I cannot hold it up with the glutes here while I'm in the stance. We call it contralateral hip drop. That's the sign of people with the hip weakness. We call it Tellenberger gait, which means that we are walking like a very uneven, or sometimes we call it battling gait, so like a donkey walk. Because when the hips on the air, the other hips so weak, so we have a contralateral dropping each time that we walk, we have a contralateral dropping. That's a sign of people with the hip issue. Sometimes people don't have enough, they are in the synergy, like people with the stroke, so they don't have enough ability to proceed with the leg, with the knee flexion. They don't have active knee flexion because knee is usually an extension for people with a stroke. So when they try to do that, instead of clearing the foot like this, which they can't clear the foot with the knee flexion, they have to do this. So we call it circumduction gait. So that's for people with a stroke. So they are doing the circumduction gait, right? But they cannot proceed with the knee flexion. The knee flexion active is non-existent. A lot of problems happening in walking, so we can really talk about it, but these are some of the most important stuff that can happen. If you feel that your walking pattern is a little off from that pattern, then you might want to work on it. Sometimes people really have some issues that they never even thought about it. Maybe that video can help you guys to understand what's the normal walking pattern is, and if you are very, very shifted from the normal walk, then you have to probably see your physical therapist or your doctors. And if you feel that the pain is limiting you and doesn't let you walk, or the lack of range of motion or lack of strength, then you definitely have to see your physical therapist to address that issue and work with you. Thank you for watching that video. I hope you have a great day.